Greetings, all in one. Hello. Today is mostly listening and kind of listening and tweaking what's left, and yeah, so I won't be talking very much. No, let's get right to it. I'm eager to get on to the next thing, so I think we're nearing the end of this one. So. Sorry, gonna start again. We really get a tour of the harmonic overtone series in that, don't we? I'm listening for a bunch of things, like how are the different sounds sounding in time? I mean, are things happening too soon or too late? The overall impact of the sounds, are things going on too long or not? Where are they in the left to right panning world? I like things to be kind of spaced out and separated, but I don't want it to sound like somebody's sitting there with the panner going, how weird is this? So I don't like to overdo that anymore. I used to like to do it, but I don't anymore. I find it annoying. For a piece like this, I generally want it to feel like it's happening all around. I don't have any movement going on, but things are definitely happening in different places. Like that antiphonal brass thing I was talking about yesterday. Also kind of the emotional flow of what's going on. I know there's not a whole lot going on, like events per minute. It's very slow, but there are things going on, so I kind of want to pace them out over time and give the ear some time to process things. And if you want to hear different things, how deep do we have to listen? If you listen to this in headphones, you can faintly make out a jackhammer in the background. And motorcycles zooming by. Which I didn't like at first, but now I kind of like them. Yeah, I like how the flanger is almost giving. It sounds like, what. Oh gosh, what's the technique? Is it sol ponticello? Just some sort of very light bowing technique that strings have, and it kind of has that glassy sound. I don't remember what it's called. Sorry, professors. I was mostly concerned that this middle section that we can see, that we're just coming out of, I was afraid that that was going to be too uneventful and too boring, but there's enough things happening for me. The thing I like about this kind of music, one of the things, is that if you want to listen deeply, there are things in there that you can, that are thoughtfully put there for a reason. Little hints of colors and changing things and little details in the background. You have to listen. So it rewards deep listening, but it also doesn't punish you for not paying attention to it. So it can kind of exist in the background. You can just kind of let it wash over you. And it's kind of true to the original, like, Brian Eno's definition from the 70s of ambient music. Today, ambient music covers a lot of different things that are not much like this. But I'm keeping it old school. And the home stretch. The last 5 minutes. Sorry, I gotta go back. Okay, what I want to do is have those voices in that talk radio bit, I want it to not reverb over their cutoff. I want it to be abrupt. Everything is reverbed in this. If we suddenly cut them off without any reverb going over the cutoff, it's going to sound amazing. So that's what I'm trying to do. That. Okay, I know. Is it enabled? Can I toggle it with that? I think so. One way to find out. There's a way to find out. Bypass. That's gonna do it. No bypass. Am I missing it? It is called enable. Okay, this is Gordon trying to figure out how to do this for the first time. Why? Oh, okay, it is doing them, okay. I see. There's a the Dub 3 plugin is echoing it, so I gotta turn them both off at the same time. No problem. Okay. Bear with me, guys. I can do this. What's unknown? Maybe I'll just flatline the in drive. More than one way to skin a cat. Maybe have that other way around. Oh no, what was it before? Edited the wrong one. Now it sounds all wonky. Doing this all wrong. What's wrong with me? I'm an idiot, and I know why. I'm just ruining it. This, ladies and gentlemen, is why you should save it before you make a change. But I had no idea that this change would be so destructive, so. Okay, that sounds all right. But now it's not doing the thing. Okay, that's better, but it's not happening at the right time. That just sounds dumb. Would it be, can I just mute the track? Can we automate muting? We could totally mute it. I went through all that for nothing. I apologize if you were sitting here watching this video and screaming at the screen, "You can just automate the mute!" So I'm gonna do that. Gonna get rid of this. It's still there. For goodness sakes, there's a lot of... Alright, no problem. Mute. That's all I had to do. Let's test it out. Okay, you see, earlier I said, you know how it's easier to just write it and do it real time in write mode? This is why, because I can't get the dumb cursor to recognize the data points on the automation strip. So I'm just gonna write. I'm just gonna hit pause when I want it to pause and edit it from there. I mean, hit mute. And delete that one. Come on. Here we go. I don't know if I like that. Doesn't have the right effect. Sometimes it sounds all right. That may work. Maybe. I want to try it a little earlier. I just saved it. Smart boy. Okay, I like that more, but how about we cut it off at the part where they, that one guy's voice kind of shouts a little bit, and then almost like out of annoyance, we just shut it off. And then there's a moment of silence, and then the final chords come in without the noisy background. I'm gonna try that. Save Reno. Alright, I know where. Oh! Don't do that. Thank you. All right, that feels good. That I like. Okay, you can't hear me, can you? Now you can. A little trick that I learned from my orchestra conductor, or the wind ensemble conductor in college, Steven Eggleston, was we would be rehearsing for hours on something, and he never mentioned this, but he always did this. He would work on it, and we wouldn't touch the ending. We might touch the ending in the very beginning of rehearsals, but he wouldn't actually play the end of the piece that we're working so hard on, just bar by bar, until the very end when he's satisfied. And then when he's ready to end the rehearsal, we would actually play out through to the end of the piece and finish the piece. And then that, I think he did it partly for dramatic effect, because when you get to the end, then we were sort of conditioned to feel like, ah, and then instead of hearing, all right, back to the beginning, let's start again, he would just say, and that's enough. And then that would be the end of the rehearsal. I always like that. So I do that myself when I'm auditioning my own stuff to myself. It's good to not play it out to the end until you're satisfied with everything that comes before that. And you might have to fix the end, but you know what I mean. So I'm going to take it back a little bit, maybe the last 6 minutes or so, and then, okay, how about here? And then see how that change played out. If I play it out all the way to the end, you know I'm satisfied. If not, I'll go back and munch on it some more. Sounds like a mistake, doesn't it? Yes, it does. Oh, well. Nope, definitely sounds wrong. Like a mistake. Unintentional. Didn't have the effect that I wanted. So. Back to the way it was before. Yep, that sounds better. I like the idea of just cutting it off like that, but you can't hide the fact that it sounds like a mistake. It sounds like an editing error. So I'm just gonna go back to having it reverb out. The effect of it stopping, even with the reverb, it's still better, I think. That sounded cool. But I think those should delay a bit. It was too far gone. Perfect. Yeah, I'll do it. I may give this one more sleep and then one more listen. I will probably do that offline. So I think this may be the last we hear of Isomerism 2 on the stream. It's close enough to being done. I'm not gonna do another stream about fixing the tiny little stuff that I fuss about any more than I already have. So I think on the next stream, we will look at Isomerism 3. I think roughly this was 19 minutes and 11 seconds. The other one was 20 minutes, I think. And I think I like threes, so I think one more piece, and I'll think about what I want it to focus on in the whole isomer concept. Maybe we'll do rhythms. And I noticed on this last listen through that I didn't use much low. It's all very high and mid, because I used the trumpet as the source. So I think we're going to explore some bass and rhythms in the third isomerism. Okay. So thank you very much. I'm going to leave you with a bit of a previous piece from another album. And thank you for being here, and take care.